Oh, the next talk is by Jagan Mohan. He's the head of engineering at Manthan. With a good mixture of technology, functional, and business skills, Jagan has been instrumental in building a powerful analytics platform and industry solutions for retail that deliver high business impact. He'd be delivering a talk on autonomous analytics, critical ingredient in successfully navigating your business. Let's welcome him with a huge round of applause. Jagan Mohan from Manthan.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. So how many of you know this hotel? So the Wi-Fi router from this hotel may be already talking to your mobile phone and gathering the data. Okay. So organizations are collecting lots and lots of data beyond the transactional data. The users are unclear what to do and what data is important and what action to take. So there needs a system that helps them to make decisions around which elements to be considered, what to do it. Okay. So today I'm going to talk about a few of the strategies and techniques that would help you to make that navigation easy. So I'm Jagan Mohan, head of engineering at Manthan. So before I get into the topic, a brief introduction about Manthan. Manthan is analytics, a cloud analytics company providing analytics solutions to consumer-facing industries. We combine math, domain expertise, and the technology to provide solutions that help the users to make their decisions effectively and also operationalize those decisions. And also, we also have an offering where they can make these, where they can actually engage the customer with relevance and in a timely manner. We take a portfolio approach to our products. We have multiple solutions. We have built it on a robust platform that does an end-to-end from a data management, reporting, and analytics. And we anchor all these things to deliver the end-to-end solution. So some of them are asking, what should the tool be? Okay. So probably my presentation will answer those questions, how a tool can help in actually, formulating your problem, arriving at a solution, and operationalize the same thing. So many industry analysts and industry bodies have actually kind of validated our product, and we have been categorized as a strong performer in the customer analytics wave in the Forrester, and we are the only company in India which has been positioned as a strong performer in the customer analytics wave. They have mentioned Manthan Analytics democratizes analytics, giving business analysts an access to big data without having to rely on IT for their data queries. So this is the kind of democratization of the data that our platform does. Gartner has cited Manthan in their magic quadrant for BI and analytics. Again, they also have said, retailer customers looking for a unified set of packaged applications supporting range of descriptive, diagnostic, predictive, prescriptive analytics should consider Manthan. So that actually explains the depth of the work, the width of the work that we actually do at Manthan. And some of you are getting the book, Where Will the Man Take Us, after the quiz. So that has been written by our CEO, Atul Jalan. So that's the kind of a leadership that, thought leadership that the Manthan exhibits in their solutions. So autonomous, why did I choose an autonomous car as an example? The autonomous cars makes the decision making, the autonomous cars make their decisions by, using the data from the camera, sensors, and they process everything on a real time and eliminate the human. So I thought, the analytics also going through the same kind of a curve, and the analytics at one day has to kind of support as similarly for the businesses to be run independently. something like Industry 4.0. So it is not what, you know, it's your, whether your car is autonomous or not. What is the level of automation is included in the car? Society of Automobile Engineers have classified the autonomous cars into 6 levels. The level 0, no autonomous, probably the cars that, you know, the previous generation were driving are of that nature. The level 1, the car does one function, like either a steering or an acceleration, right? So if you are having an automatic cruise control in your car, then you are having a level 1 autonomous car with you, automation car with you. The, some of the cars, they do two functions, like, you know, steering and acceleration, right? So it is like cruise control coupled with lane centering. So those are the kind of a cars that, you know, come under second level of automation. The, from the level 2 to level 3, it's a huge jump, okay? So technologically, because the car started, you know, detecting the environmental factors, okay? The cars will be able to accelerate in the slow-moving traffic, okay? So it is like traffic jam pilot by RDA8 is one of the examples. Level 4, the cars can be driven autonomously, completely independent. The human is not needed for many of the scenarios, okay? But they are currently running only in a controlled environment because there is no infrastructure that is needed. So by the time we actually reach to the full automation, the cars have to start talking to the fellow cars, the cars have to be start talking to the traffic signals. So that's when I think we would have a full automation is achieved. So if I kind of, you know, match this with where we are in terms of the analytics. So level 0, I think some 20 years back, 30 years back, the MIS departments taking the data from the transactional systems, creating the Excels, and then, you know, creating the tables, and then giving it, sharing it to the CEOs, senior executives, and that's the only decision-making tool available. There come the BI and visualization tools. They have come with exception highlights, trend highlights, you know, report bursts. So they were doing, you know, they're helping the MIS department of, you know, creating the reports in a routine manner, but, you know, they're just doing, getting the data, putting it in Excel, and then sending it. So the level 2 of an automation has come when the people started using the predictive models. Predictive models are there for over 15 years, right? So they're, the banks have started, banks are calculating probability of default, and then they were including that into the, their models before they decide whether the loan has to be granted to a person or not, okay? So they were actually primarily there, and then they were doing a one function, and they're integrated with the operational system. From level 2 to level 3, it's a big jump. What has caused? The cloud, big data, it has actually caused this big jump, where the amount of data that is coming from all kinds of sources, whether it's a sensors, IoT sensors, social, you know, the environmental data, all those things started coming in. But again, the cloud has made it easy for to, you know, store the data at the cheap, and then also is kind of, you know, process the data when it is needed. So that's when it's a big jump in the analytics has happened, and the modern analytics and BI systems are catching up with that particular kind of a jump or that kind of a phenomena that is happening. So the Gartner is calling that as an augmented analytics. Okay, I'm going to talk more details about it in a in this presentation. The next thing is highly automation. So I think it's in a controlled environment. One function it is doing it. You know, we all have seen Amazon Go, no checkout stores, where the cameras and the sensors are detecting what the user, what a customer is doing in the store, and then accordingly billing the customer, and then providing with the, you know, whatever is the offers. Full automation. I don't think we all will be sitting when the full automation, sitting in this room, when the full automation has come, because the machines themselves decide, because the analytics suggest what to do, and they decide what to be done, and we all not required to be sitting here. Okay, so there are lots of things happening around the digital, in virtual image, and all those kind of stuff. Okay, I'm not going to get into the detail. What is needed? So the most important thing is, the lesson here is that it is not that, you know, how much you have automated. So it is that, you know, it is a journey. So we have to increase the level of automation in this particular thing. As Albert Einstein said, it is insanity to repeat the same thing over and over again and expect a different result. Whatever that we are automating, it has to be intelligent, right? And so the most important, the augmented and intelligent is the one part of the pillar. And the next part is automate everything, because and it also has to work at a scale, right? You can't be running a churn model today and the next week you forget about it. You know, it has to be like an experience. You have to kind of continuously score the customers. You have to continuously kind of, you know, measure whether they are kind of giving you a respect behavior that you wanted to do or not. And then integrated. So one of the good examples that, you know, one of our customer has said, so there is a good relationship between the belts and the watches. Okay, so one of our accessory customer had done a promotion on the belts, okay? And their watches have gone out of the shelf. There are no watches in the store, and everybody was, you know, the store manager is kind of asking for, hey, like we need more store watches into the in the store. Okay, because this analysis, somebody who's recommended the belts, they have not actually looked at what are the other products that can go along with the belts, and they have actually not planned for the enough stock to be in the store. So that's when we have to have, you know, you are not looking at one particular thing, what should the promotion on a particular category, but also should look at, you know, what are the other categories. They should have done a market basket analysis, there's some kind of an association mining, and look at it, okay, these are the other products that could also get lift. And then hence I need to have enough stock into this. So primarily, okay, so the system has to be augmented, automated, and integrated to increase the levels of automation. Before I get into each one of these topics, I just wanted to kind of show you one particular case study where one of our customers has used the existing infrastructure to create a better experience to their customers in the retail shop in an offline mode. Okay, so you would have seen a similar stories happening in the online when you are actually browsing or purchasing on an e-commerce website. But here, the store lighting, they are the Philips VLC lights, so they are like acts as a beacons. They emit a certain unique identification code. Your mobile camera can actually recognize those unique identifier codes and then can determine the position of the person in respect to the distance of the aisle, where in the aisle the person is kind of standing, and can give that position, and the retailer's app can actually correlate that data with the customer profile and send this information for any particular personalized offers. Okay. So how did we do this? So we have a Manthan customer analytics solution, a CDP platform, which can actually get the data from all sorts of sources, all sorts of customer interaction behavior, and we create a single customer view. Okay? And then on top of it, multiple models that actually enrich the customer profile, like RFM scores, customer, you know, transactional behavioral segments, and everything gets added to this. And parallelly, it also creates an item affinities, which product will go with which customer, and which product will go well with other customers. Okay, you know, people will buy bread and eggs together, or whether people will, all those things gets created. And when a mobile app sends out the user context to the target one, which is a personalization engine, in a real time, it does two things. It actually scores what is the customer mission in this particular trip. Okay? And based on the customer mission and what the customer is doing in the store at that particular point of time, it sends cross-sell and upsell kind of an offers. Okay? So this is kind of gone live with one of the customer in Singapore. And they are actually kind of, you know, enhancing it to actually do in-lane new product offerings. So whenever the customer is there and there is a new product that is kind of placed in the aisle, so they're going to create a communication about those products. They also kind of can do reminders to the customers, have you missed this product? Or also they wanted to do something like, okay, if customer has bought two products in a particular recipe, then they can actually start predicting that which recipe customer wants to do, and then start recommending the other product. So there are multiple use cases. It like once they've created the entire infrastructure, it can actually open up for many more opportunities. So from a from the use case, if I come back into the, you know, what this augmented analytics, what is that, you know, the system has to do to be intelligent. First, it has to accelerate the insights. Okay, so the product life cycles have come down. So previously, the people used to have, you know, the product life cycles in the close to 2 years, but now the product life cycles have come to 3 months. People wanted instant gratification. So the insights has to come quick and in a real-time manner. Increase the adoption. Still, there is a huge barrier in terms of the adoption of the analytics in the organizations. So there are only certain section of the people that who use the analytics, then the other set of the people are completely kind of ignorant of what is happening and reduced bias. So when we as a data analyst start looking at the system, you know, we know that the churn could happen because, you know, there is a bad feedback given by the customer. Okay, probably there are 100 other reasons. As an analyst, you know, he's not considering it. That's the bias. So analyst is adding the bias when a system actually does the analytics. So because it does not create that, you know, preset mind, so the bias gets removed. Okay, how is these things can be happening? So in the world, you know, in the good olden days where, you know, if somebody asks you to build a model, there are like, you know, 5 steps. So you will ask what are the variables to be used. Okay, where is the data? Then you will model the data. Then you create certain kind of, you know, data exploration path, then build the model, and then explain the model and then put it into action. So this is a very long path. So it takes a hell lot of a time from the problem area to finally the model has been kept. And again, there is no feedback loop into this. Okay. So the augmented analytics actually aids the machine. The augmented analytics uses the machine learning to aid, you know, data and the analytics workflow. So they actually, it's a kind of, there are lots of technologies that has come to automate the data preparation and then make it ready for the analytics. And the analytics systems, it automatically able to operate on the data, so the catalogs that is created by the data preparation engine, and be able to build, create the models, narrate the data, and be able to give it for the actions. So here, because the models are getting narrated, so the skills are the kind of, you know, training that is needed for the business users have come down. So that means it will increase the adoption, right? So again, because the number of steps is eliminated and it's all, most of the steps are automated, the time taken to actually from the data to the analytics have come down. And because it is happening continuously, you have not taken the data from a data lake and given it to a consultant. The consultant has written this particular program and left it, right? So in that case, there is no feedback loop, but here there is a feedback loop. So because the data is continuously coming into this, so everything, your analytics and your data, everything is converging into one place. Okay, so that increases the adoption. So this is the fundamental framework. So what are the components that is needed for you to kind of ability to put a system, right? You know, we at a Manthan have identified, you know, 4 major modules or a major section that is needed to create a system like this, okay? And there are companies which are doing only one part of each of it, okay? And if you have already some analytics system and wanted to kind of see that you need a help with this, you can choose to start with, you can choose up that particular section. Like there are lots of companies are working only in intelligent data preparation and enrichment, okay? I don't want to name the companies, but you can just find out, right? So similarly, there are just companies, they're just doing automated machine learning and intelligence, okay? So they are auto ML models, okay? Then there are companies who are doing just NLP, and their company is just doing an NLG. So, but we kind of identified the 4 areas, and the system is actually has been getting built in around these things, and then all at one place to give you a consolidated, a converged analytics. So the business user talks to the analytics system the way that the user interacts with a Google or an Alexa devices. Okay, and then he asks just a question. So in the morning, the user do not have to wait for the dashboard to be sent to a mail or something like that. So user would just ask the question. So hey, what is my business update? Right. So the system automatically looks at various parameters that the user will be interested in, understand what is happening with each of those parameters, and then only the important. I have a section on how we score each one. How do we identify those, the important parameters? So all those important insights that the user has to be known will be sent back in a. Using a natural language generation manner. So the user asks the question, system understands the intent, translates into database queries, runs those queries, the automated insight engine finds out the insights, and the natural language generation translates that entire insight and relays back to the customer or the user. See, one such example, when a customer asks, what's my weekly sales from the last 12 weeks? Okay, in the old days, people has to say, I need a line chart and everything. So now the system automatically creates a line chart and then says that, hey, this looks like an increasing trend. And it also says that there are two change points where there is a jump in this particular data, what's my average and how, and it, if needed, it can also interact with the AutoML model to say your forecast for the next week is going to be the X, right? So there could be a question whether that how robust would be that forecast, okay? Here where the parameters are very less, so you just gave the 12 points and expect the 13th point to be predicted, it would be as good as what it is. But it gives a directionally by incorporating the trend and the seasonalities that the system has actually already understood. Couple of things, when we actually started the journey of naturally, so the things system has to understand the trend. So this is not exhaustive list, but I just giving you very high level. System has to find out what is the trend, what is the seasonalities. It has to start speaking of the seasonalities. Now we are, the retailers are now going towards the festival season, right? So most of the things are going up. So I shouldn't be saying that, you are doing very good. Right. You need to compare with the last year and then see whether they are really doing good or they are actually doing bad. So it has to understand the seasonalities, change points. So all of a sudden something has happened, or when Amazon has come, all the retailers started going down. So that's a change point. Then people can actually see what has happened. So that will give you more insights into what is driving your business. Weekdays, weekends, consecutive increases, decreases. So these are some of the things that system looks at it. So when it some of the things in a descriptive analytics, the system looks at correlations. If I have a user asks for two metrics, it looks for correlation so that it doesn't have to say, then this speaks out about it. Central tendencies, variabilities, variance, standard deviation. So it does univariate analysis, multivariate, and lots of things, okay? But at the end of the day, it will come back with 20 points that need to be spoken about. Okay, and in the Monday morning, somebody tells me the 20 things, it is like, it is worse than a report, right? So if I start speaking, hey, your store one is bad, your store two has improved, so it's bad. So we need to see what information has to be given to the users, which information is not needed, okay? So there is an entire scoring engine that is needed, okay? And then we came across a situation. So a user has asked, what's my sales by category? Okay, so we did great show, then we said, okay, yeah, your department one is 65% of the entire sales and it looks very great. Oh, okay, so it's over, first week is over. Second week, the user asked the same question, what's my sales by category? So nothing changes, right? So that same category will become from 65 to 64.5. So I can't say that your category one is very good. Because after a certain point of time, when you are actually giving the same analysis again and again, it has no meaning. Okay, so basically then your analysis has to start changing it. What is changing in the business, right? When a user is asking second, third, fourth time, then you are saying you are identifying what the system has to do. Then it has to see how actually measure from what has happened last week to this week, and is there a significant changes, and then it has to start speaking about the changes, right? So these are the kind of a challenges somebody has to, like, initially it looks very easy because all of you may be doing some, you know, all these things, techniques, when somebody has given you the data. But when you are actually operationalizing it and you kind of let the users, you know, week after the week or a day after the day, so these are some of the things that, you know, one has to be considered. See, other experiences that I wanted to share with you is around the, you know, conversational engines or the way, you know, the way that people interact with your Alexa devices or a Google Home kind of devices. Okay, it looks very good to start. You know, it's very easy. All right, so you just create an interaction model in the system, and you start asking it, and then it'll give the result. Okay, but you know that's only a starting point. Okay, trust me. The moment you start creating an enterprise data model and put it in an interaction model, the system will confuse a hell lot of it, right? You know, it gives nothing, okay? So, but it's very good to start with such devices to understand where, you know, where you start and how you operate it, but, you know, quickly you have to move to some robust systems. And people will kind of, you know, give all kinds of spelling mistakes, people will kind of, you know, so one of the questions, you know, what's my sales in tops category? Okay, so there is a tops as a brand, the tops is a category. So the system has to resolve the ambiguity in this, right? You know, is the user is asking for a category tops, or is a user is asking for a brand tops? So some of these syntactical models will help to kind of understand the relationships, and then, you know, say that the user may be doing it. And certain cases we have to go back to the user and ask, hey, you want for a brand or you want it for a category? So such kind of things the system has to be put in place. Semantic. So what is my top store? Okay, and what is the store with the highest number of sales? Which store has contributed no highest sales to the organization? All mean the same. So you need to start understanding the intent and then, you know, identify what the user is planning to do. Okay, and there is no kind of a model that kind of automatically be available. You have to train. Of course, the models are available, right? So you can use any of the semantic similarity models, or you can use, I think, the Roboto model from Facebook, some of these things, but you need to train. So we started training with domain data. They didn't perform well. So, but what we realized that, you know, you had to kind of use any of these other corpuses from Quora and other things, and then on top of it, you train with your domain data will going to kind of help you and improve the accuracies. And it should be contextual. So you can't be kind of, you know, user is asking about, one of the things is like, you know, how many male customers do I have? The system says, you know, you have 4,042,000 male customers, right? Then after that, how many of them are best customers? So now it can't start saying from the beginning, right? It has to say, it has to understand that the customer has asked for a male, and then he's asking for a best customer, and then you have to kind of filter it, basically the male, and then say that. So the system has to, it's a simple example, but there are many places this will start failing, okay? So the system, you need to have a robust contextual model, and then, because we are saying that NLP is going to be kind of, you know, phase for your analysis, so these things has to, the system has to be able to kind of, you know, explain what it is saying, okay? And many places it is not possible, and you do not know whether you wanted to give out everything because you don't know what the customer wants it or not. But you need to be providing the guided path for the follow-up analysis, right? So that, you know, when a user is asking for a particular metric, you say, you know, this is the related metric do you wanted to know, or you wanted to drill down more into this. So these are the kind of things that are important. I think many people here has been speaking about various models, okay, complex models and image recognition, maybe NLP or churn, that we are all been hearing it, right? So the best thing at a platform level, some of the things that what we have done is that, you know, created some automated ML models for regularly used techniques. Okay, so initially when we started doing it, okay, so we have a one response modeling and a churn modeling. People have a different way of treating the data, and everything has been created. So we realized that the people have, there is a lot of similarities in what people have doing, and it all has to converge. Then we came up with set of models that can be automated, so they can, you can actually train on a different kinds of data sets. For example, classifications, you could have create an ensemble model, use lots of techniques within this. You use logistic regression, SVM, or neural net models and all those things. Once you have your model that got created, right, over a period of 2-3 projects, then you can use it for any kinds of your, whether it's for a churn prediction or whether the customer is going to unsubscribe from a particular campaign. It's only that keep changing the variables, you keep doing it. So for that, you need, again, a one-click configuration. So you should be able to start tweaking these models with various parameters that they will do best for that particular situation. Okay. So this is the other reason why, how it allowed us to kind of, integrate the predictive models into some of our, some of the automated insights be also using these things. Okay. So again, there's lots of events happening, okay? So the organizations are becoming very big these days, right? And it is humanly not possible to really track every single metric. And you need a system that automatically tracks particular event and start identifying and then highlighting when an anomaly happens, okay? So the way that it actually does is that I think we kind of use profit initially, later we kind of use lots of other things that added to this. So it identifies when there is an anomaly, that the particular metric crosses a threshold, and it also looks at relevant and related metrics or an event to say what is contributing to this particular anomaly, and then start communicating to the, or notifying to the user, okay, hey, this is the kind of a problem that happened, and for user to take actions around it. Okay, and one good, some of the examples, so we kind of working this with one of the, very high fashion retailer, okay, and the system has detected, at initial level where, some QA is kind of looking at what has happened with the smart alerts, and the system has detected anomaly of low sales value, okay, and then when the kind of relationship with other metrics have been given, the quantity has shown as inversely correlating with this particular thing. So the person has said, hey, no, mathematically it does not looks correct. How can your sales be low and your units are high, right? Because your units into average value will give you a sales value, right? But because it's a high fashion retailer, okay, so whenever there is a discount, so they kind of really do a deep discounts, okay, and the sales kind of go very high, okay, very particular days, and the sales goes high, and then this kind of entirely kind of make the model behave differently, and it kind of, we need to make some adjustments to kind of factor those kind of things. See, this is one of the, how do you find anomalies for certain metrics which are related to the life cycle, okay? So it's like when you have new product launch, the category manager will be very curious to know how this particular product is done. You have a campaign that has been executed, so you wanted to know how and the campaign is done. But what is the comparison? You say that 50,000 people has opened the campaign in the first 2 hours. Has no meaning. It has to be kind of you need to see what is the proportion of the people generally open in the first 2 hours, so that you see that the campaign is kind of working well or not. So what we created is that we kind of normalized the metrics to a same time period, okay? So these are, in this case, we have multiple product launches happened, and then what is the kind of sell-throughs on that particular respective week. So when we brought all of them starting with this, so if a particular new product is at this point on a week two, I should be able to compare, if there is an outlier to week two, when a new product is launched, what would be the behavior on the week two? And then be able to say this, whether there is an anomaly on this. So now the system is doing lots of analysis at a scale, right? So currently the BI systems are dashboards. They're very passive. The human has to go to the dashboard and to see whether something has kind of happened or not, okay? So you can see, so this is the area where lots of current dashboarding tools has to be kind of evolved to a next level. There should be more cooperative between various models created by different vendors, okay? To be able to kind of say that, you know, to be able to kind of bring the insight from the bots or an algorithms that is doing it. You know, these algorithms find trends, anomalies, and all. So bringing to the user, the right user who wanted to consume that information. So this is like, you know, the dashboards gets automatically created like the way that your, you know, your news website is, you know, personalized based on your interactions. Okay. In this case, where the user is asking, you know, the sales by store, then the system is actually telling you that there is an anomaly. So the user is actually not asked for it, but you know, it's still saying that, okay, hey, you may be interested in this information. And you know, this is what the bots has detected, that, you know, but these things can be given it to some kind of a, you know, alerting tool or a control centers. So user will be able to act upon it. And there's a feedback mechanisms for the system to say, hey, this is a right kind of an anomaly that the system has detected, so that this can be actually be improved going forward. Okay, so this is the foundation layer, which is about the data preparations. So there's a huge amount of data that is coming in, like, you know, some of the customers would have up to 20, 30, 40 systems that are feeding the data, internal systems. Right? So this data needs to be cataloged first. You need to understand what columns that the particular thing, what are the columns or an attributes that particular data that it is coming in. Okay, if there is a semi-structured data, if the text that has come in, it needs to be enriched with understanding the sentiment of the data, understanding the tags in that data. Okay. And then harmonize the data, so there is it can automatically look for the joins, and then, you know, harmonize the data, and then create a curated data lake, which can be readily used by the data scientist or the tools to be able to provide the insights. Okay, and one of the examples is, again, you know, the retail store location, and we can actually start getting the local events or the local weather that can be actually used to predict any particular metric. So these are the components that I have actually, talked about it. Okay, so there are independent vendors obviously doing a particular function. There are tools like Mohan, which is kind of trying to bring all of them so that they can work seamlessly. Okay, and I will walk you through how we have put all these things in action for one of the biggest global consumer brand. Their challenge is that they've been doing pricing model for a long, okay? Any kind of a consumer brand worth its salt has a pricing models embedded into it. But, you know, but they're doing only for a select category, select products, you know, only select regions, okay? So what they wanted to see is that they wanted to increase this particular thing. They wanted to increase the reach. So they wanted the model to be built for huge number of products and across every region, okay? And then, the category managers should be able to start using it. So we said, you know, we can start, we kind of wanted to apply this whole thing of natural language generation or conversational engine as the model for interacting with the system, understanding this. So the people, but you know, how do you kind of find out the accuracy? How do we create a trust for the users? Okay, if the system says, you know, you should decrease the price by 5% to get another 10% sales. How do the system able to kind of, how the user will be able to create a trust in it? So what, there is a set of sequence of, you know, questions that has been, I just got a question, but I'll just come back how we have done. So the things like diagnostic questions, how sensitive is my product related to the price changes? So this will tell them that, you know, if you decrease the product by 2%, and then you can expect your sales to be going up by 4%, right? So before we recommending it, we kind of say that, you know, from a historical model, that's the kind of things that you have identified. And also your user wants to decide, okay, in his portfolio, if there is a 10 products, he wanted to kind of see which products are most sensitive, right? You know, which products are most sensitive to do this. And then predictive and prescriptive, we really couldn't put that as a, you know, a conversational thing. So we had to take out as a what if, and then system does it, and then email a complete report. So one example, the user is asking, you know, once all the data has come in, so.
Total shipments for the last month is 23 million. Shipments closed at 0.92 index over last year on volume and 0.95 on value. Customer with positive impact is Gmart with index of 1.1 for volume and 1.11 for value. Customer with negative impact is United with index of 0.78 for volume and 0.80 for value. Subbrand Acme has slower shipment index over last year in the past 3 months compared to past 6 months. Projected sales for the next month is 25 million less than planned sales.
So here at the end it is saying that the projected sales is negative, then the user can ask the questions about what's happening.
Last month sales for Acme has decreased by compared to last year.
And then, you know, in this business, what's happening with the competitor is most important.
Last month sales for competitor Bambi has remained flat with 1% compared to last year.
So here, like, you know, the category manager, I have actually simplified the story for this particular presentation. The category manager has understood that, you know, his products are doing bad compared to the competition, and he has to do something about it.
How do you get data? You have control over your.
Yeah. So your Nielsen and the IRS of the world will kind of share this particular data. So that's where it is. But the most important thing is, how do you choose the competitor for that particular thing is an important. So we had to put a model for that also. So select for one of your product, the competitor could be A. For the other product, the competitor could be B. Okay. So when we are actually scaling it generically, so again, we need to kind of create a set of model that kind of identifies what should be the competitor. Okay, so that would also be easy, but again, system knowing it and then flexibly keep changing the competitor to say, hey, this competitor is.
These questions are hard-coded or Maya is dynamically learning?
Maya is learning these questions, yes.
So when we talk about the analytics, so let's say when I'm asking what is competitor's growth, it's throwing an answer to me. Is it also throwing more of a prediction to probably give an additional insight to the customer?
Yeah, so the next one will kind of come to that, yes. So like...
Subbrand Acme has for national market...
So the user has asked for a key driver.
0.8 index over last year on volume. Key business driver one is price. 2.3% drop in price has 7% increase in volume. Key business driver 2 is trade feature and display with 4% increase in promotion has 5% increase in volume.
So because it uses the model behind those things, okay, and then it actually, I have a follow-up slides how we have generated this data and how we kind of, you know, able to answer this. Sure. I'm not covered in this, but I can talk it offline. Yeah. Yeah, it should be able to understand it because of the semantic model that I was talking. So it also kind of knows what is the words that are important, it actually identifies what is the intent of the particular user. And then it does the NER to identify the respective keywords and then run the model.
It should be able to
hard code. Yep.
straight off question that I'm asking, but I do ton of spell errors, grammatical errors, and I throw all kinds of mixing over here.
So there is a level, as you know, that NLP, as thirds is evolving, okay, I shouldn't say that, you know, it will be able to handle all such all kinds of situations. So there is a part of you know, a spell checker, and then we kind of that is been embedded into it, which identifies what is the closest word that it is coming in. So some of the times you know, when you kind of put actual data, it can start behaving, so, but it's learning, it's, the system is evolving it.
Report is successfully delivered to your mailbox.
So it's finally this. So what is kind of what we had done differently compared to what any of the consulting organizations may be doing it, right? So most of the consulting organizations are already, are maybe doing in the process of where the manual thing is there. So they actually see initially, they actually fit what is statistically best model. And so the variables get tweaked, so they create the model, the variable gets tweaked, and then finally include those variables that are best explaining this particular thing, and then actually they kind of try to achieve the perfection in that, okay? So they're definitely the more accurate models that these companies would create. But when we actually made from a manual to automated model, here, see, there is no governance here, so the model is running behind. So some countries, you may have very sparse data, or for some categories, you may have a sparse data. But in other countries, it is good. How do we do it? So it is, basically, we have codified every single variable that is possible. And then we just kind of applied the brute force, gave it to the system, and the system has detected the best model completely on a statistical parameters, okay? So it's like there is no human intervention that is done, okay? So there is a possibility sometimes the model may be giving errors, okay? But, you know, we ran the model with their best categories, the best products, for the best products and the best countries where they have a sufficient data, the model results are comparable, okay? But, you know, as we go towards the tail end of the products, you know, there could be some model loss, but anyway, they were not doing anything else, okay? So just to kind of, you know, a couple of things that we kind of have created, two things we have created for every single product or every single and for every single product and every single region, we created the you know, key driver analysis. We kind of kept that data, and then we also have created something you know, due to analysis, what factor is causing the, you know, change in the sales. Okay, so whenever a user asks for a question, if the data in the system are, you know, is stale, then it goes, computes it. If it is already available, it doesn't go and then run it. Okay, so to give a confidence to the user, it actually kind of answers things like how equivalent are affected by price changes. So these are the ways that the you know, business user understands the particular concept of, you know, how the price model fits. Okay. Sorry. Okay.
Now,
basically, based on what we have seen with multiple customers in our journey with our platform, I thought of sharing a couple of insights. If somebody who wants to take this particular path, the most important is converge your AI and BI journey. You cannot be kind of setting up one and then expect the full result. So your BI system should be feeding for your all your ML work, and then the model, once it has been operationalized, you would be able to score and then completely get the results. Integrate with operational systems. Okay, so that's the way that you can automate the functions. Select the tools that have extensions and API-based integration. So this space is evolving quite fast. Okay, so you need to select some tool, whatever it is. So that should have an API integration. So when something has been detected by the bot that you have selected, that should be able to kind of feed back the results to your dashboarding system. Look for quick wins and iterate fast. So don't wait for a best semantic model to be built. You know, start with what is possible, try it, and then keep building on top of it. When you're building your automated models, feature engineering is embedded, design the model for the scale, so it should be able to kind of run for all kinds of scenarios, handle noisy data, explain the models. Think, how do you explain the model so that the user will have a confidence on the model that is getting generated? Okay, so save all the parameters that is important for explaining the models. So integrate the systems in a closed loop manner. So this I've spoken already. So that's it from my side. Any questions?
What kind of tools do you normally use to customize tools or any open source tools?
So we use some of the open source tools to and we embed them, we create a wrapper on top of it, and then we present the completely unified experience to the customer. Yeah, so one is that for us, because of the domain centricity, so we know what is the problem, business problem that we are solving it. So initially we start with, like as I said, customer churn as we are packaging it. So we build a model for that particular solution, okay? And then we create a wrapper for end user to kind of hypothesize various scenarios and then able to give the results. Okay, and if the same model can be used for any other business scenario, right? So we use standard engineering practices of reusability, modularity, and then you kind of fit this whole thing, and then that model keeps getting evolved to become a more robust. Data. Yeah. So most of the times, as you kind of, if I have to do an actual, any kinds of a forecast for this particular thing, right? So if time series model can explain only that much. So you need other dependent variable data, like what's the kind of a promotion that is running, what kind of an events that is happening, and those kind of things, right? Yes. So we have to use RMAX or some kind of other models which actually kind of fit these external variables. So the important thing is we often do not get all the factors that is needed for doing this predictive model. So it kind of, again, as I said, people will start with one and then they iterate by adding more data, because it is created a tool, a solution approach. Then people do not have to start from the scratch. If there is a new information is found, they just have to use a couple of ticks and then drag more variables, and they should be able to kind of arrive at a solution. So it actually accelerates the consumption of these models.
I have a question. So since we're talking about operationalization over here, and now three things, we're talking about 2019, three things are prevalent. One is the volume of data set. That's the vertical volume.
Yep.
That's going crazy. And secondly is also the horizontal scale. So you said that you have manually coded statistical tests for some of your parameters. But when things go beyond control, probably let's say 1200, 1500, and there are data sets, there are problems that can attribute to this. Now, in this space, there would be times when we cannot just make everything manual, and Kubernetes is one platform that can help automate.
Sure.
So what's your say on these things? So how do we operationalize in this?
See, one is that some of the cloud auto the Kubernetes, some of these things has helped, right? If we have to run So there's a lookalike model that we have created. Okay, again, it's completely unsupervised model. So we kind of pushing it with some 1500 variables, and then you know we wanted to kind of see analyze it. So the a GPU instance gets created, and the model is run, and then you know the everything is. So the cloud has helped in doing such things at a scale, okay, without worrying for the cost. And obviously, the Docker and Kubernetes is going to help in this.
Okay, so I have a question here. Listen.
Okay.
Sorry. So for augmented analytics, you said that you are preparing data with AI-powered systems and all. So what kind of tools you are using and what kind of automation you are putting in for the data preparation part?
In a data preparation?
Yeah.
Okay. Couple of things. One is that we're doing it at multiple levels. Okay, so starting with understanding the because we work with a particular domain which is a retail, so we know what the retail data would look like. Okay, so we have models to actually given a sample set of data, so we actually kind of identify what is the column is about. Okay, whether this particular column is about a sales, or is it the column a dollar column, or is it talking about a discount, or is it talking about a units? Okay, similarly in a customer master is a good example, right? We have a model that actually somebody gives an complete file, so we kind of automate models like, you know, looking at the files, and we'll say, hey, that column is talking about an email address or a telephone number or an address. Okay, so that is one example. Then we also have a models for a data standardizations. Then the models for deduplication. Okay, so these are the and then householding. Okay. Then the models will also kind of do compare the contents to see what are all the columns that are can be joinable, right? You know, you have a category as a or a product in one of the entity, and the other entity there's a SKU. But looking at the data, it says, hey, both these columns look like the same, and then should be able to kind of start joining, creating the relationship between these things. So this is some of the examples, but there are many.
One last question. So when you are training this particular thing, generally, what is the
It kind of.
If you just talk about the retail, like you talk about that retail function, within the retail function, what I'm trying to understand is that through that training set, you would be trying to bring together a lot of different business perspectives so that the questions in different business contexts could be understood and answered, right? So, what my point was that generally, how big a training set is with which you guys are starting with so that it covers 80 to 90% of the thing, the business context, and if in case that 10% then how do we deal with that?
So is this related to the NLP part of it that you are asking?
Maya,
right? Okay, great. Right. So first thing what we kind of have done is like anybody would do, apply an ER model, start understanding the entities, okay, and then build the queries. Okay. From there, the moment we kind of start getting into a semantic model. So we had to start somewhere. So we started with the three examples. Okay, so our product manager Manish is also here, right? So we started with the three examples and then said, okay, so I'll start with the three models. This particular, only three things, top stores, and what are the other two? So we started with,
for example, we can have multiple, I mean, thousands of patients we created. And they're all, we outsourced a couple of vendors also. And a couple of 5-6 people also. Right, for 1 month, and we created those entire list of patients. Only 12 of us take this. So that's how we created the training set.
And once it is done, then later, whatever is the user is asking, where the system is not understanding, we'll just put those things separately. And then it's a next cycle that gets added. So after that, it is actually a repetitive cycle for us.